evening. Welcome to In Your District. I'm Linda Kelleher. I'll be your host for our conversation with City Council District 5, Councilwoman Donna Reed. Good evening, Donna. How are you?
I'm good. I just saw the most beautiful sunset. We were up at a meeting at the Pagoda, and if you're looking at the TV, quick run out and look at the sun, because the sunset is stunning tonight.
Yeah,
I think it's one of the best I've ever seen, and when we're up at the Pagoda, we see lots of them. I took lots of pictures, post them later.
Yeah.
Beautiful night. So enjoy this beautiful weather, and let's think about the people down the Bahamas and everywhere else, and in Savannah and Charleston, and that don't have the weather we have. So especially in the Bahamas.
Yeah.
So,
well, let's get into transportation funding. We got hit with a little surprise.
A little surprise, big surprise. And I guess most people know by now the media has covered this pretty strongly, especially the Eagle, Holly Herman and Beth. What has happened is the allotment of federal funds that come to the state are being sort of reevaluated by the MPO representatives and PennDOT in terms of how they will be allocated.
Are they being reduced to the federal funds?
The federal funds constantly get reduced.
Yeah.
I mean, you would hope they would be increased, but there's a reduction. But beyond that is the issue of how they're being reallocated, which impacts not only us here in Reading and Berks County, but throughout the state. There's only two parts of the state that aren't impacted and are seeing a small increase in allocations to what we call the state highways, the 61s, 183s, things like that. Johnstown and another western Pennsylvania town are the only two that are getting a little bit more money, like 2 or 3%. The rest of us are seeing a significant cutback in the federal funds that are allocated through the state to us, again, for the Route 61s, the 183s, the 422s, 222s, all your state roads, 10, 23, all the ones that run through Reading, Berks County, as well as the rest of the state. And what's happening is they're allocating the funds that are being allocated. This group that got together in Harrisburg and had like a three-day confab about it, the determination is those monies, millions and hundreds of millions of dollars now, will instead be diverted to the interstates, I-81, I-80, I-78, all the other interstates that run through I-95, that run through Pennsylvania. There's a lot of reasons for this. One is the fact that we as a state, we're the Keystone State. And from day one of the 13 colonies, pretty much everybody has to travel through us to do commerce, to get to where they need to get to. So those roads are really key roads for the U.S. transportation system as well as ours. The problem that we run into, and we certainly want all the roads to be taken care of, but the cutbacks that are going to impact us, and I think it's up to about 43% over the next, we're in 2019 now, 2024 to 2032, 10, 12, 13 years. The cutbacks will be in hundreds of millions of dollars for projects here in Berks County. Again, we're not the only ones, so we're not alone. Harrisburg area, the western part of the state, Scranton, Wilkes-Barre, everybody's being hit.
Yeah.
So it's not like we're alone. But the impact of that these smaller highways that are so important for commerce, for travel, for people getting to work and back, school buses, school kids, all these will suffer because of all the monies that are being diverted now to the interstates. And it's a huge issue for the whole state, not just us. Again, those two little pockets, and again, what they're seeing in terms of increases till through 2030 are minimal.
Yeah.
So they're not really even benefiting. But to think that our allocations could go down by 43%, other areas 35%, other areas 45%, it's stunning, and the long-term impact of this for the next decade or so will be enormous, and who can project 2030, 2032, what kind of monies and funds will be available? I mean, if we're struggling now, how are we going to get that revenue then? It's very worrisome, I think, when you look at it.
Yeah, and I guess the question you raised when Alan Piper, the transportation planner, made the presentation, you questioned how that decision was made without any input from elected officials.
Correct. I'm the council representative, and we all take turns being liaisons to different boards, but I'm the council representative that sits on the Reading Area Transportation Study, which is our municipal planning organization for our road system. And generally, we approve projects here in Berks County of funds that are allocated to us through the state, through the feds. And generally, we make those decisions, as do the other MPOs throughout the state. But what happened, you know, Alan came back to us, and our chair, who is a PennDOT district person, came back and said, well, these things were decided in Harrisburg in July or June, and we met in July. We meet every other month, so we're meeting again next week or 2 weeks from now. So we were told this happened. We weren't, our votes didn't go to agree to this. It seemed like it was, democracy wasn't in action here. Representative democracy wasn't in action. I think we're all really concerned about that. And that's a point we were making. And I hope everybody else across the state is making this point to their cities and their counties and their municipalities, that two or three people made those decisions for us. They were charged with making the decision. Frankly, if I was a representative and somebody would have said to me, you made this decision, I would have said, wait a minute, no, I have to see what my board wants to do before I give you my opinion.
Yeah, or the state legislature.
Exactly. I mean, that's even more critical.
That board can make a recommendation, but then it should have to be approved by some higher
Correct.
Authority.
And they were sort of taken by surprise.
Yeah.
Our state local delegation was. And I was glad to see that you received the letter from Judy today that was sent to Transportation Secretary Rhodes. The concern about this and the impact it's going to have, and the impact it's going to have from, you know, certainly here in Reading, we look at the economic development. We look at safety. That's always paramount. But the implications for economic development that long-term it will have as we're trying to come back, you know, we were looking at a $650 million rehabilitation of the West Shore Bypass.
And they just started talking about that 2 years ago?
Correct. And that was scheduled to start pretty much 2022.
Right.
And then that would go through about 2030,
right,
even beyond. Because it's a huge project, $650 million. A couple of us have been advocating, and this is where the one time the administration and council are together, for a bridge to be built over North Wyomissing Boulevard into the city. That's really needed to take the traffic congestion off of
Bingham,
Route 12
yeah.
and Binghamton and Buttonwood and Penn. We need that. We should have had that bridge in 2000 before the hospital moved out there. But new bridges are, I mean, it's probably going to be very difficult to see that occur.
Yeah, now.
It's probably going to be very difficult to see just the much-needed rehabilitation of the West Shore, the volume of cars on that every day. And it's $650 million sounds like a lot, but how much does it cost to do 1 mile, you know?
Yeah, and I mean, not to complain, they did some work on Route 12 mm-hmm. this year. It stinks.
Yeah.
They didn't do the whole thing. They
no.
picked selected rectangles.
And that's what will happen with the West Shore, because instead of a smooth, flowing, all-encompassing project, which of course has to be done phases because you can't just shut down the West Shore, but you know, it may be like, well, this stretch of 2 miles is going to be a problem. One of the things that they were going to do with this was rehab which we just rebuilt, the Binghamton Street Bridge.
Yeah.
Not Binghamton Street, Buttonwood Street, excuse me. The historical arches, we just rebuilt that. County spent how much? It's a county-owned bridge. Now those arches will have to come down and be revamped so that we can expand the lanes.
Yeah.
But will any of this happen now? What will happen as part of it? There was even talk about redoing the overhead railroad bridge.
Yeah.
That alone's a nightmare because Norfolk Southern would make us pay for the reconstruction of a second bridge till we could reconstruct the first bridge. These things are you have no idea how complicated, and I'm only saying it from a layman's standpoint. It's insane. But then to lose this kind of money for everyone else, the city of Reading, we have our small highways. We have 61, 183, 422, 222. We're impacted. Perkiomen Avenue is business district. All those things are impacted. But then you start looking the spider web of roads in the county and how that connects us to the outside world. We already have our challenges. No rail, no passenger here. Buses are limited. I mean, it's going to make us even more of an island.
Yeah.
So I'm glad for Judy to have written that letter. I believe our state legislative delegation is united in this. I think anybody who serves in municipal government has to be united in this. our county commissioners really have to speak up about this as well. We all have to be one voice.
Yeah.
And that's across the Commonwealth, not just here in Berks.
Yeah, that was shocking.
I think we all felt like, I think that's the most excited I've seen Council President Waltman in a long time. He wasn't a happy camper bat. And he used to sit on rats.
Yeah.
So maybe we have to cycle Jeff back into rats, you know?
I don't know if rats can take him.
When we reorganize in January with our different jobs, you know. But it's you know, it's a scary thing, and it's going to impact all of us.
So after Penn Street is finished around November, December of this year.
Coming in ahead of, under budget.
And ahead of schedule. So then they have planned to do some rehab work on Bingaman. Is that still in the plan?
I believe that's still in a plan. And then also on Schuylkill Avenue, there is a little
railroad bridge.
It's between Greenwich, between Green and Buttonwood, more or less.
Yes.
It's right where District 5 and District 6
come together. Fire station, the former fire station.
The Star City Boxing now.
Yes.
That's what they call it. So that's going to cut down, that's going to close down part of Schuylkill Avenue for a while because that has to be entirely redone because what happened with the double-decker trains now, it's too low. They can get through, but it's too low. So I guess in a weird way, that'll be part of the Buttonwood Gateway because as that happens, that's going to happen. So it's going to be very interesting. But
and again, Norfolk Southern takes no responsibility.
You drive around and you see the railroad bridges and the rust and the shape they're in. You know, people say, oh, that's Reading, oh, that's West Reading, oh, that's Sinking Spring. No, it's Norfolk Southern, and I just don't know how they get away with it. I'll never understand it.
No, I will never understand
that
myself.
As a reporter, you can never get comments from them or their precursors, and as municipal officials, we never get answers from them. I mean, people even have to get permission to clean the railroad tracks when there's scads of trash on it.
Yeah.
Go figure.
Yeah, and they're unwilling to have people come and volunteer to do that type of stuff, mostly.
And the railroad cuts through our city. The railroad has always cut through the heart of our city.
Yeah.
Not just Penn Street at 7th. Through the heart of it's geographically divided our city since, 1837?
Yeah.
So anyhow, that's on those happy notes.
Yeah. Yeah. But, another thing we have coming up that's pretty impactful is we received DEP's recommendation.
Yes.
For the repairs or removal of both Bernhardt's Dam and Egelman's Dam. So Egelman's Dam, they drained about almost a year ago.
And it's not what it had been. I mean, you think of all the fisheries over there, the Isaac Walden League, which is a historical group going back to Great Britain, coming over here with wildlife and conservation. The impact it's had on neighbors up there. With wildlife, frogs, things like that going into people's yards because their habitat has been destroyed. That's a big, big consideration.
Yeah.
And the rebuilding of those is expensive and sometimes against what DEP and the state want, but you know, that was a pretty interesting place up there.
Yeah, so we have two public meetings coming up in mid-September. The 18th,
yes.
September 18th at 6 at the Shabbat is the Bernhardt's meeting. And the 25th at the Pagoda is the Egelman's. Mm-hmm. So we were also kind of surprised by the state, where the DEP sort of backed out of coming.
Isn't that great?
Yeah. But we wrote to our Berks delegation again, yes. Senator Schwenk and Representatives Caltagirone.
And Rossi.
Rossi. And they put some pressure.
Yes.
On now it appears they're reconsidering.
Which is great. And we really want to thank, you know, Mark and Tom and Judy, I mean, they have been united for us to advocate for the city.
Yeah.
And in this case, advocate also for Lower Alsace and
Muhlenberg,
Laureldale, because these particular city properties directly impact the neighbors in Lower Alsace, directly impact the neighbors in Reading, in Muhlenberg and Laureldale. So, you know, this is a multi-municipal concern. It's our responsibility, our liability as a city, but you know, none of us is an island, none of us lives alone here, and if we have to be good neighbors to the people where we own property, just as we would expect people in Onalani to be good neighbors to the Reading Area Water and to the Onalani Dam, things like Onalani Lake, you know, we have to all be good neighbors to each other, and I know growing up in Muhlenberg, and Marsha even more so than me because she grew up on that side of Muhlenberg, up in the Reading-Muhlenberg border there, the importance of Bernhardt's to the community and as a recreation area, everything we've gone through with Exide and the pollution and the cleaning of it and the remediation of it. There are so many levels with, Eggleman's has a lot, no question, but Bernhardt's has even more layers of how are we going to deal with this, whose responsibility, the steep slopes, the island in the middle that no one could get to remediate back in what years was, I was already on council.
Oh, it's, the early 2000s. It closed in 1998.
So it was the early 2000s.
Yeah, actually it was around 2008 when the project got assigned over to me.
Okay.
And then we finally started the remediation in 2010. So it was like 2 years of meetings, mm-hmm. conference calls, emails with the DEP, the EPA, and Exide. And when I was on the phone with the Public Works Director, the council president, and the DEP, I asked the question, why was this issue never raised during all those conversations about the remediation of the park? And I got crickets.
And a cricket's probably knew more out there.
Yeah.
This is what makes you a little bit crazy with government. You know, it's understandable how the populace looks at us. We're their representatives. But sometimes as much good as a bureaucracy does do and becomes the standard, you know, the continuity between elected officials, there are certain more entrenched parts of the bureaucracy that somehow don't give us the answers we need. And then we are shocked or we are left in limbo or whatever. And again, we're not an isolated case. This happens. I'm sure you talk with your colleagues throughout the state. Yeah. I'm sure they tell you stories about what they've gone through.
Yeah, every municipality has its challenges.
Mm-hmm. We just have a few more these days.
Yeah, well, and you know, the challenges are all different. Some of them are very similar. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. You know, like Allentown's going through something that we went through back with Mayor Oppenheimer mm-hmm. about mm-hmm. making non-employees acting directors.
It's always an adventure. We never know from week to week what's going to, and nor do they. Nor do they.
We're very lucky to have that community.
Yes.
Of other city officials together and talking.
Yeah, sometimes you just need that.
Yeah.
You really do.
You do. So we've got a big week coming up with 911. What's planned for the 911?
9/11, we have the annual ceremony in City Park. We encourage the public, I know it's during working hours, but if you can be there, please be there. I believe it technically starts around 9:55, but mm-hmm. try to be there like 9:30 or so. This year, and we hearken back to our good friend John Slifko, who still manages to make a difference even though he's on up there in the clouds. Last year, he was a very strong supporter that we not use air raid sirens because, especially in this day and age, with everyone freaking out, understandably, if those would go off, and that has happened the last couple of years. This year, and we thank John's advocacy, as you noticed, it was in the minutes last year, pointed out to us his advocacy last year, along with everyone else, that let's ring the church bells at the time of the towers, the falling of the towers at the World Trade Center. And I believe this year the church bells will ring in the city, correct, Linda?
Yeah, that's Public Works coordinated all that with churches, so all that's lined up.
So that's really, it's far more soothing to hear those church bells from a spiritual standpoint, no matter what your beliefs are, to think of the folks whose lives were lost and who were sacrificed in that terrible day. And again, we thank John advocated for so many things for the public good. And I think you're right, this is testimony to John. So even though we haven't had him with us since January, he's still helping us out, and we appreciate that.
Yeah, well, I got an email about the sirens, against using them, and I thought back to last year, and I thought there was something about the church bells, and I went back to those minutes, and was mm-hmm. like, oh, it was John.
There was John. So thank you, John. We know you're hanging around us.
So Oktoberfest is coming up, and there's sort
the
of a special addition mm-hmm. to.
Yes, and the Liederkranz, even though it's in our neighbors in Lower Alsace, it is the number one U.S. Oktoberfest, which is stunning. So all of us here in Reading, I'm sure many of us go up there. So it's not technically a city, but it certainly is our next neighbor, and and we're partners with them. Linda, you're on a Mount Penn Preserve partnership. Right. So we're all together on a mountain there, and we're all partners, and it is a really unique municipal partnership, public-private. And the pagoda, of course, is up there. This is a fire tower, two city-owned buildings. And at the pagoda on October 4th, and I won't go into a lot of details, but I would mark your calendars for 9 to 12. Actually, we're starting at 6 in the morning, so you might want to come up for the sunrise. We'll be working with WEEU, and I will leave it up to my colleague, Marcia, because it is her district, and she will be having all the plans. She's a chair of our Pagoda Foundation, and she's done a great job, and I think we're going to have a lot of people up on the mountain throughout Oktoberfest, which I believe starts that Wednesday.
Yeah.
Wednesday the 2nd.
2nd, yes.
And then continues through Sunday. But on the 4th, the morning of the 4th, we're going to have something great at the pagoda, so come on up. The more the merrier, and parking, we might be doing shuttle service for parking. So it's going to be a good day. So, Linda, I hope you can get out of the office for a little bit.
Yeah, I'm actually scheduled off that week.
Oh,
so we'll see how that works.
Hopefully
out.
You can come up and join us. That might be a good week to be off.
Yeah, I know.
I think I need to volunteer that leader cross.
I usually do.
Get my time in there.
So over the summer, we experienced, we experienced a great upheaval in local celebrations with the use of fireworks.
Which has been, I don't know if you had any on Labor Day, but we did in our neighborhood.
No, I was shocked that I didn't hear anything.
We had them. We had them over in Berkshire Greens.
Wow.
But you're definitely right on 4th of July, that whole time frame.
That was insane.
And we had damage. We had a house that burned.
A school,
Amanda Stout, the roof. This isn't a joke dealing with these fireworks. And shame on the state legislature for having opened up
the sale
of the more industrial strength fireworks.
Yeah, they allow the sale of them, but there are still restrictions on the way they can be used. So if you live in a third class city, you can buy them, but you can't use them.
And how do you explain that? How do you enforce that? I mean, God love our police officers. They did yeoman's work for this. They were fabulous. But this is a city of probably 100,000 people. We hope in census 2020 there will be a full or complete count. But based on our school district population, we're probably between 95 and 100,000 people in Reading. They can't be having their eyes on everyone. And everyone celebrates 4th of July differently, culturally, whatever. But the fireworks were out of hand. Dangerous, scary. I'm surprised we didn't have more personal injuries, or maybe we did and we don't know
Just don't know about them, yeah.
But once a house burns, once a roof of a school's burning, that's enough, you know. So I know
They had a similar experience with the volume of police calls in Lancaster.
I saw that note that you shared with us. So hopefully our state legislators, our local delegation, again, we thank the three of them, will be, Judy especially, has stepped forward on this to try to move into a better law.
Yeah, and we did do that outreach to our municipal colleagues in third-class cities and asked them to contact their local delegation.
Absolutely.
Increase the pressure. Yeah.
And speaking of pressure, let's hope that our fight and fills right about now are winning that game. Tonight's the second playoff.
Oh.
And then it's best out of five. They're playing the Trenton Thunder. And then tomorrow night and Saturday night, they'll be in Trenton. If there's need for a fifth game, I presume they'll be coming back here. So I have to just put a plug in for our Reading Fightins.
Yeah, that's the first time.
And those are legitimate fireworks out there.
Yeah.
Those are fine.
Those are legal.
Even though my little grandson was stunned and was like, what is that?
Yeah, with the fire department present.
Yeah. And those are okay. We're not criticizing those fireworks. Although sometimes on weekday nights, my constituents in Riverside are like, what? You know?
Yeah, but they've even altered the way that
that. They've been much more respectful of weekday nights versus weekends.
Yes.
So that's all worked out. But, I mean, how could anything be wrong with that stadium, with those Reading Fightins, with the manager? We have such a gem out there. Marcia and I always sort of like get cranky about, well, she's got the pagoda and I've got the stadium, but we have one heck of a stadium. I think the stats came in, 15 million visitors over the course of time. Number one, America's Classic Ballpark, number one, Minor League Park. I mean, we are so lucky to have that. And those of us who grew up around here, we remember a very different municipal stadium when we were young than what we have now. Muhlberg used to play football out there when I was a kid.
Yeah.
So we have lots of good things here in Reading. Fall, lots of really cool stuff coming up in the fall, both in the city and in our outskirts. And I don't know, Linda, I think it's, I'm very hopeful that good things are ahead. What do you think?
Yeah, I'm hopeful too. With the train station.
Exactly.
Saucony,
and that's the, we have the grand
opening. The
ribbon cutting is Friday the 13th.
Right, Friday the 13th at 4.
And if you have not been there, we don't advocate for any one business, but we always try to highlight the new people that come in. We appreciate anyone with confidence in a city who comes in and establishes themselves. And we love the businesses that have been here forever. We appreciate the new folks coming in. And they went through a lot to establish themselves there. So we are we're very happy for that.
And to just to hear them talk about their vision for the areas.
Oh, yeah. And how people are, it's really caught on dramatically.
Yeah.
And give a quick shout out to our co-counselor, Jahani.
Yes.
Cepeda Frites, she is now opening yet another of her Mi Casa Su Casas in West Reading. So I like to think that West Reading and Reading, especially now with the new Penn Street Bridge, it's time for us to link hands, and hopefully with the efforts of Jahani, with our new people here and new businesses here, that we'll have much more synergy across that bridge, that beautiful new bridge, new bridge, under budget, ahead of schedule.
And those lights are beautiful
as
you're coming, down the West Shore.
And did we fight for those? I have to give a shout out to Carol Snyder. She and I fought for those lights to go on that bridge.
Yeah, they're really beautiful.
And it was worth it. So thank you, Carol Snyder. Your work paid off, your advocacy.
Well, we got the goodbye sign already.
So it's time to go. So if you're out and about, check out our beautiful places in Reading to enjoy and share some fellowship. And they're all over the place. And get out there, enjoy the weather, enjoy our beautiful city. Have a great fall, because I think it's probably going to be well into November afterwards till I see you again. So thanks.
Have a good night.
Bye.